Lord greatly praised. It's so good to see everybody on our final Sunday of our 4 weeks of fire. So excited to see everyone. Today is a good day. This is the day that the Lord has made. And I will rejoice and be glad in it. And the Lord says that goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. So when you wake up this morning, you have goodness and you have mercy following you. As you walk around your house, there is goodness, and there is mercy. Everywhere here this morning, you are followed by goodness and mercy. As you see the people when you walk in here, you are followed by goodness and followed by mercy. That is something worth rejoicing in heaven. Amen. I'm going to pray the Lord in prayer and open up this service the way we ought to. The Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for another opportunity to be in your house and your presence among your people, God. So we thank you for this evening. And I believe those who made a sacrifice to be in your house this morning are going to be greatly rewarded for their efforts and everything. God, we experience the rules of this evening. God, we ask that whatever you have done in this service, let it be done. Anything that is trying to cause a hindrance or distraction in this service, Lord, we bind it in the name of Jesus. God, we can't rise up and cause division and distraction among your people. God, prepare our hearts and our minds. God, we praise the Son of the Lord and the world is still faithful. God, please reach your people in this room this morning from the front to the back and across both sides. Lord, let your spirit be filled in this place. And God, do what you showed us to do this morning. And let the church say, amen. Watch the words of the Lord as it's recorded. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. You'll find yourself up here
Thank you.
people go hugging, some people go around and try to associate with everybody. This is an opportunity for you to get out of worship. Go across the church, find somebody, and greet them in the name of the Lord. Welcome them here. And we're glad everybody is here today. So why don't you tell me just welcome one of those
just one more time. Let's get the gears a little bit. We're still at work. We're getting different types of I'm going to go to the hospital.
Thank you. Come on, let's do it like we need it for a moment. Come on, let's go now here and shout from the church this morning in the name of Jesus. Is there anybody that's been brought up, sanctified, and saved by the power of the Holy Ghost?
Yes! Hallelujah! Oh, we give you praise!
Feel at home. I'm so thankful to be invited to be with you this morning in Jesus' name. I'm going to tell you right now, I feel a sweet spirit in here, and that's really important to revival. And I feel very welcome, and I feel that we have a house full of genuine people, praise the Lord, and I'm thankful for that. And just so you know, your pastor and his wife, they're genuine, real people too. They're good friends of mine. And so thankful for their friendship in my life. Praise God. Now, Vinny, Pastor Vinny, he's about 100 times better preacher than me, praise the Lord. So, hopefully your expectations aren't that high for me this morning. He's one of the best ministers I feel like in the whole state of Ohio. So, you guys are very blessed to have Pastor Vinny. We're going to go to the Word of the Lord, Genesis chapter number 39, and we're going to read verse number 7 through 12. You still have a little bit in your tank? All right, can I preach this morning for a little bit? All right, I feel like God gave me a word for us specifically, for every person in this place. It may not be a shouting word, but it's going to be a word that will encourage us and help us understand some things. So Genesis chapter number 39, verse number 7, say praise the Lord whenever you're there. And it came to pass after these things that the master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, lie with me. But he refused and said unto his master's wife, behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in the house than I, neither hath he kept anything back from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And it came to pass that as he spake Joseph, day by day, to every day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie with her and to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men in the house there within. And she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. And I'd like to preach this morning about Ling Chi. Now, you don't know what that is, do you? That's all right. I'll tell you what it means here in a minute. But let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for what we feel in this house. I need your anointing to preach your word to your people, God. These people are set apart. I believe that you're going to use them powerfully for such a time as this. Father, we're going to be here this morning, God. And I just pray that your spirit would have its way in Jesus' name. Every single day he fought and overcame the temptation. Every single day there was a battle and a struggle with his flesh. And every night, you know that the enemy attacked his mind and tried to convince him to give in the next day. Over and over, day after day, he had to fight this and he had to win. Over the centuries, mankind has come up with some excruciating ways to torture other human beings. Some torture is done to punish an individual for something they have done. Some torture is performed on a person to get information out of them. Torture means the act of inflicting physical or mental pain on somebody in order to persuade somebody to do something. Whenever studying torture, I found some nasty examples of torture. The first one that caught my eye is called the brazen bull. Has anybody ever heard of that? It's a bull made of brass that would be slowly heated up, cooking the victim inside. And the horns of the bull were designed in such a way to turn the victim's screams into music. What a horrible way to die. This is a fact for you. The person who actually created that instrument of torture was the first person that it was tested on. So, the next way is the rack, and that's a bed that is formed where you lay the victim on it and you tie their ankles and their wrists near the head and the foot of the bed of the rack, and the rope is slowly tightened and it basically dislocates the victim's sockets with their knees and their elbows and their shoulders and their wrists, leading to dismemberment. Another way of torture is through enurement. This would be the least way I would want to be tortured to death. Just so everybody knows, I don't like tight spaces. This torture involves locking somebody in a small box, and whether you bury them or just keep them confined in that little structure, the person would slowly die of death after going insane or being confined. That is horrible. Just the thought of that just makes me, another way that I thought was pretty nasty was rat torture. What they would do is they would take an individual and lay down and they would put a metal box with a rat over it and they would cook it and begin to heat it up and cause the rat to basically shoot through the person's stomach. And I know it's Sunday morning, but I'm not trying to be too nasty, but that's no way to die. Praise God. It's super crazy whenever you think about the very
cruel and dark things that people have come up with ways to torture each other. While I was in prayer, God spoke to me just these words, blessed by a thousand times. Whenever I heard this phrase, I knew kind of what it meant, but whenever I studied it out, I actually found out that it was a vicious type of torture that was used by the Chinese people up to the 1900s. When the Chinese people, with the word for this is, you guessed it, lynching, which means death by a thousand cuts. This torture was a very slow process that brought a lingering death on an individual. This torture was not used to give information and then release, but this was to torture the victim into execution and to kill them. And this form of torture and execution of knife was used to methodically remove parts of a person's body until they basically bled out of your death that resulted in their death. The executioner would make a 6-6 slice in somebody's thigh on Monday, and then on Tuesday they would come in and cut their Achilles tendon, and on a Wednesday they would come and remove half of the person's ear, and then the next day they would come and cut a 3x3 section out of their arm, and this could go on for weeks or months at a time before the person would die of blood loss or infection. And just about this little problem, because it's going to make you look that is left undressed will become convincing. A second-engine life unaddressed can easily turn into a major regret. A small thing not dealt with can very quickly become a root of bitterness that in our hearts. Many things add up to good things. The little things in life are usually what makes up the big things in life. If you look at a car and there's thousands of pieces and parts, and they're all not a car company, so it's overwhelming to me. But if you pop that engine out, there's a lot of little things that make the car go. It's the same way in your life, in your spiritual life. There's a lot of little pieces and parts that they may seem small, but I'm here to help you understand that they are very significant to your spiritual man continuing forward.
We build a house last year, and we were really excited about it. If you've ever built a house,
God has ordered everything here. How to be accountable in small pieces, how to put together the things, this product and this product, and it is the same way in our lives. That one seal that did not get installed correctly could be the beginning of a flood in your house. It's a small thing. If you know that little seal that they put on the bathtub, and you don't install that correctly, but then they put the bathtub in, then they put the drywall in, then they put the floor in, and then you move in and turn on the water and realize, hey, we got a problem. It's just the smallest little thing that is behind the scenes that's going to cause major repairs, major issues, major things down the road. And so we have to do the small thing. I see the enemy working like this all the time. I've been in that room for a while. Nothing is more frustrating whenever you see one of God's people with 100 cups. And then they come in and there's just a bunch of little things going on in your life. And you try to minister to them and try to pour out into their life. And the next week they come in and they have 250 cups. And you can just see it on their face. They're just stressed out. They're stressed so thin. And the enemy is imposing them on so many fronts. And it's just and then you see 500 cups in their mouth. It's so hard to minister to this type of attack because it is not one main thing. Right? And if you come and say, here, I got my arm chopped off, it's a problem. We can know what to work on. Right? It's there's one main issue that's fine. This type of attack is so hard to minister to because it's so many little things that are very helpful to the big things. And I know that I'm in the Holy Ghost because the Bible says in the last day, Satan would come to wear out the face of the Most High God. How are we going to wear you out? This little thing. You get wore out by having this just I've been working 6 days straight, right? And then you go to Tuesday and Sunday working to make money. You know what? I got to go back out and you get wore out because of the whole week. It's just like a mom. Sometimes I'll show up. My wife will be so stressed out from with the kids all the time. And we'll be sitting there, and one of the kids will still glass of milk, right? And she goes crazy. You know what I mean? I'm like, hey, that's not make it here. You know what I mean? Let me clean that up. But the problem is, it wasn't the one glass of milk. See, I'll come in fresh to the bottle, right? You know, I'm just coming working. You know, but the problem was, they also spilled juice earlier. They grabbed chips into the carpet. They hadn't been listening all day. The one had an accident, you know what I'm saying? They hadn't cleaned it up. But here I'll come in like, hey, what's wrong? You know, like, you get so upset over one glass of milk. But you see what I'm saying? It wasn't just the one glass of milk. It was the fact that all those 80 of these things had happened throughout the day. That one glass of milk, sure, it was the last straw, if you will. But it was not just that one isolated thing, and that's the same way things with our lives. It's like, wow, you're really getting worked up about this, and it's like, you don't even get so upset about this, but I got all these other things that it just are mounting up in my life that's causing me to break because of this one issue. So the still milk all about itself is not the problem. It is all the things that have brought us to the brink of insanity. You may be thinking to yourself, you know, this is me. I'm stressing over this little thing to my job. I have health issues. I have tattoos. No, kids need more for me. I'm aware that isn't what it needs to be. Praise and reading is like, you know, I've been having to make this major decision in my life. The insurance premiums are rising. It's so much for me to deal with it. And then what happens if you step, you lose it, and the enemy wins. So this is an unbounded cross. It's like the saying, everybody's ever heard of the struggle that breaks the camel's back. A single piece of straw only weighs 67 pounds. Insignificant. If I had my straw in my pocket, it's not like at the end of the day, I'd be like, man, I'm fine. You know, I'd be carrying this straw all the way. It really doesn't matter. It's a small thing. But a barrel of straw, which consists of 10,000 pieces of straw, weighs 90 pounds. Now listen, I can see a lot of you are strong people. But if I carry around 90 pounds for a week, guess what? At the end of the week, you're going to be right out. You're going to be so-and-so ended up quitting. Why did they quit? Oh, this happened. It's like, it wasn't, that's not why they quit. They quit because of knocking down, they were all kinds of other problems. It was just destroyed. Not something here to be small, but whenever you put all those small things together, you don't understand that that is an attack from the enemy. Many battles were fought to win World War II. Put that little picture up there. World War II was one of the bloodiest wars that was ever staged. And if I were to ask you about it, probably of you could give me some very much details about it. But for the most part, what we know is that we won. Hitler won. The Germans won. You may think something what we got from the Congress won. Right? Those are what they think. You may be able to tell me a few details about what happened. But listen, this war was not won in one battle. Oh no, there were literally, if you can scroll down, there were literally hundreds of battles that decided the fate of the war. So as they scroll through this, go back to the top. You can see there's hundreds of them. You just click on one of them. There's each one of these little lines that we saw, whenever you click on it, each one of those lines, that subcategory, that breakdown that talks about where it happened, the strength that took place in, the people who were involved, the generals, the type of weaponry that was used, each one of these has little details in and of itself. And the war was won on 100 different battlefields and 100 different fronts. And the enemy had to be defeated every single day. Whether it was in the South Pacific or whether it was in the Mediterranean, every day they fought and won on the front. And I'm going to talk to you just for a moment about front. Well, what is a front? A front is in your home. A front is in your home. The church is only as strong as the home, praise God. And what you don't understand is the church is victorious because you're winning on your front. Just like these little details, each one of you has your own details about the lives that you're living and the things that you're facing, the enemy that's coming against you. He's not attacking him the same way he's attacking you, and he's not attacking you with the same weapons he's using against you. But I'm telling you, we all have fronts. It is these real battles that we see up that caused World War II to be played in our favor, and it's the same way in the church. Your little battle that the enemy has been trying to convince you and tell you that it's insignificant. I'm here to expose him today to let you all know that the fight that you are fighting is not insignificant. It is very important. It's important to the church. It's important to the kingdom. It's important to your family. It's important to the lost souls in this community who do not have the Holy Ghost. Don't be deceived to believe the lies of the enemy that what you do is not important. It is so, so vitally important. Do not despise the teachings of small things. Why not? Because the evidence of your soul does not. If you stay up here this morning, okay, you speak of that. In the text, it was every day the enemy showed up to take your soul down. Everything to do with the biggest pressure to give in every single struggle to let go of the conditions. And I can imagine that if anybody's been feeling like failure, the enemy's been attacking you every day. So I'm about to show them this right now, but you're going to just let the Lord know. He showed up and said, hey, why don't you die? Look what I'm wearing. I'll put this on for you. The next day she flies in and she gets really close and she kind of gets a little warm up and says, look, you smell the perfume I put on for you today. Every single day, the enemy, before you encounter him, like make preparations to try to get you to fall. Every single day, she says, no, not today. You know, that's not like, you're not going to there to try to convince him. But he didn't matter. He was already second in command. He was in charge of everything that Pharaoh had sweat. And he humiliated him, trying to get him up to the throne. He said, this is something small. Just get in. I'm not letting him. It's not going to be a big deal. You'll be able to have it. It's not going to change anything. You're still going to be second in command. Thank you.